Hey guys, how's it going? And welcome back to another YouTube stream. This time we have a very special guest. It's Alice Sara Ott. And right off the bat, thank you so much for that donation. You know, it helps me buy ice cream during these times of quarantine. Ice cream is my one and only friend. So thank you for that. But anyway, I've been super excited for this guest because Alice is not only a fabulous musician, she's a world sought after pianist, has played with Berlin Phil, Munich Phil, London Symphony Orchestra, tours all over the world, Japan, you know, Korea, China, the US, Europe, basically on all continents except for Antarctica. She is just everywhere. So I've been really, really, really looking forward to this. And before we start, we always have, of course, piano facts. But so let's go straight to that. Piano facts today. You know, the piano was invented in Italy in 1709 by Bartolomeo di Francesco Cristofori. That's nice. Yeah, I guess the violin is just a little bit older than the piano. The piano was originally called the pianoforte because of its ability to play notes both quietly in piano and also forte, loudly as well. So, you know, because before that, the harpsichord could only play softly. It was, yeah, not the pianoforte. So the piano has over 12,000 parts, 10,000 of which are moving. I mean, that's pretty incredible. There are 230 strings needed for a piano to make its full range of sound. And that full range includes, goes from the lowest note you can play on a double bassoon to the highest note you can play on a piccolo. So it's basically an entire orchestra in one instrument. So yeah, that's pretty cool. And you guys in the chat there feeling educated? Yes, I definitely am. But anyway, I don't want to delay the introduction anymore. So please welcome this week's special guest, Alice Sara Ott. Woo!
Whoa, what an introduction. Hi, Ray.
What's up,
Hi,
Alice?
Everybody. So how much ice cream did you buy?
I probably have at any given time, maybe like 2 tubs of ice cream in my freezer.
Whoa.
Yeah.
And then how fast are you eating those?
Well, you know, it just depends, you know, how sad I am. But hey, is it nighttime where you are?
Yes, it is like almost midnight. No, it's 11 p.m.
Oh my gosh.
But it's okay. I'm a night person.
Okay. All right. Well, thanks for doing this live stream. You know, for once I didn't have to get up at like 9 a.m. like 8 a.m. or something like that.
Though I've probably written you when you were still asleep.
Right. By the way, I have my drink here ready, so cheers. You know, it's nighttime, you know, you
cheers.
You have a
cheers.
Yeah, wow. What, mine's a full glass.
Yeah, sorry. This is a penicillin, so it actually contains 2 kinds of whiskey.
Oh wow, yours actually has alcohol. Well, mine is a
what?
Mine is a big boy drink too. It's iced tea.
Well, what is yours?
What? It's a drink. You know, it's a drink. Yeah.
It's okay. Here it's nighttime. There it's still there's daylight. No, is it daylight?
It's only 5:10 p.m. So, yeah, that's
okay. It's too early for drinking.
Yeah. Well, you know, I mean, yeah. It just, but I made sure I made the color look like yours, right?
It looks really nice. Yes, actually, it's really good. So, what is it? Is it tea?
It's
or
iced tea.
Is it juice?
Yeah.
What?
Oh. It's. Well, hey, you know, I have so many young people. You know, guys, let's not drink, okay? So that's
true. Drinking is so
bad for you. No, you can drink when you're an adult and when you make adult decisions. But anyway, so Alice, thanks so much for joining us today. We have a bunch of people who have submitted piano playing videos. And, you know, honestly, I don't think I've ever had so many submissions as we did this time. So we're going to have to just, you know, go through them pretty quickly. And I tried to fit in as many as I can. That we might have to have part two one day. So let's get right to it.
I'm ready.
All right. First person is Johnny. He's 17 years old, and he's playing the Beethoven Piano Concerto number 3. It's the cadenza. So we're starting in the middle of the cadenza.
Nice.
Very nice.
It's a very difficult cadenza.
Wow. Why is this? Okay. We're just going to turn that off.
Oh. especially after this cadenza.
This thing where I do boomer moments all the time. We call them boomer moments, and we keep a boomer moment count. And that count is rising because you don't realize this, Alice, but while that last video was playing, it apparently was echoing because I forgot to turn off both monitor and output, and people in the chat have been telling me this whole time.
Really? Oh, really?
Yeah, and I was just like, that's why I was just like, I was not, I hope you focused on the piano video. You know what? We've got to listen to the beginning part again, just so that we give Johnny a decent chance, because it's not fair to him. So I'm so sorry, Johnny. I'm so sorry. Right. I thought that was that's one of the quarantine things that
cannot get your tuned. That's true. It's I eat that click all the time. Dope. It's a nice integration.
There we go. We finally had a chance to listen to it properly. What did you think? Now that you've had a chance to listen to it twice,
I'm really impressed. This is a really difficult cadenza, and it is written in a very romantic style. And I think he caught the different moods very well. And I loved the colors when he actually went into the side theme, which is in G major, and I thought it was really beautiful. I mean, the only thing I would encourage him to do is to actually, when he changed to the more dramatic part in F minor, to make a bigger difference, because I think in Beethoven, you can really make these sudden changes and point it even more out.
Okay. So those are, like, Beethoven is definitely more of a contrasting type character, right? He's just got a very, kind of... Yeah, if it's going to be something, it's going to be 120% when he does something.
Sure. Yes. And I think that makes his music also so interesting, because, you know, he has the sudden changes, and sometimes when you don't expect it at all. And I think it is the beauty of his music, too. And I sometimes really enjoy not to prepare a certain mood. And I think especially when he goes from this G major to the F minor, and there shouldn't be any preparation, and there's a sudden change of mood.
Okay. So that it's just, yeah, we don't need to just suddenly, like, we can afford, I guess, in Beethoven. I guess that's the same as Bach. Maybe that's maybe something from an older time, because I feel like the more romantic you go, the more people prepare harmonic changes.
Yes, in a way. I think also Haydn is a very good example for me. He does it all the time. You know, he has these hidden jokes. And obviously, Beethoven was studying with Haydn as well. And I think this is what is so exciting about music, because the audience sits there and there's things you expect that happen, and then there's sudden changes and sudden surprises, and this is what makes music so interesting, because there are so many possibilities, and when there is a change that you didn't expect at all, this is what makes you happy and excited in that moment.
I see. Okay, great words from Alice. You guys are writing those notes down, right? Because I certainly am. Anyway, thank you for that, and thank you to Johnny. Sorry about the boomer moment, and but you know, personally, I'm sure reverb. It sounded probably like you had four hands, but you know, it was great. We managed to hear it the second time around the proper way, and now I'm kind of a little bit scared for the other videos. I hope I have done this correctly. I'm so sorry if I haven't. So, Alice, this is just a common thing, okay? So we're gonna listen to the next person. Is Daniel? He's also 17 years old. He's gonna be playing the Chopin's Revolutionary Etude.
Wow.
Incredible. Is that normal not to use so much pedal in this piece? I feel like don't pianists love pedal? Nice.
Yes, usually they do. Yes, but yeah, and that's what I like very much about this as well. I think pedal is overrated very often. There's so much you can do with your hands. Even you know, playing a nice legato does so much more than just pushing down the pedal. And I like when people play Chopin with less pedal. I thought this was really, really nice. And you can hear the left hand really crystal clear and still feel the emotion of the right hand. This was really nice. This is, again, a very typical piece.
Yeah. That's, go ahead, sorry.
Oh, no. I also think that the challenge of playing the Chopin etudes is to not make them sound like etudes, like studies, and to really present them as character pieces. I think he has done it very well.
What would you say if there's one thing that he could improve upon or think about, you know, perhaps just to, you know, phrasing wise, musicality wise, something that, you know, he could take away from this, just one thing.
I feel like I'm repeating myself now, but I would also add a little more mood differences to this piece. It is very dramatic. It is full of fury and lots of anger and also excitement. But I think there are also parts in which you can feel there's a little more doubt and. I think he can probably experiment a little more with different moods in this piece as well. I mean, it's quite a short piece, mm-hmm. And there is lots of repetition, but still, depending on the harmonies, I think there's a little more one probably can do.
Do you think that he could benefit if he used just a little bit more pedal? Because we have people wondering in the chat about, hey, would it be, I think it would be easier if there was more pedal. Or you know, do you think that could help, or do you think it would take away?
No, I think it could definitely help as well, but it's not all, like, it's not just pushing down the pedal again. You have to also do it first with your hands to create a difference, because there's lots of things you can do. You can play with dynamics. You can play with the weight of the hand. Even in the left hand, you could try play a legato instead of like a leggero or a yeah. So sorry, I'm using now music language.
Oh, but no, there's
different things you can do. It's not just the pedal. There, it's always a combination. But of course, adding a pedal in some parts would also create a nice effect.
Nice, nice. Okay, so there you have it, guys. Pedal used, let's say, judiciously, very carefully, is the way to go, and to not over. I mean, I've personally experienced pianists, you know, playing together and totally getting blown out of the water because when they hold that pedal down more, let's say even a second longer than they should, it just, all that sound just accumulates and, you know, violinists, we poor violinists on the receiving end are left with a very small sound indeed, almost no voice. So,
are you talking about me?
No, not at all. Not at all. Actually, but Elise and I, we played together a couple of times as well. Chamber music, trio, I think, yeah. And also in recitals. I was thinking, did we do a quartet one time? No, it was just trio. Right?
No, we did trio. Trio, yes. But I remember once you were telling me, I mean, it was a very boomy piano, and you were telling me, it's like, could you play a little softer? And I felt like I was already playing a pianissimo, and still you were blown away by my sound.
Your sound was just really too powerful. That's all I can say. It was just too powerful for the space.
But I was barely pushing down the keys.
No, yeah, exactly. I think it might be like a thing where we're so used to, I mean, we always try to project in these 2,000 seater halls that, you know, it'd be interesting to, I wonder what the sound will be like after we've come back from quarantine. Maybe our sounds will all be like,
it will be. No, I think because we have to compensate, it would probably be like triple loud.
That's true. Well, that's one of those things I've always been envious of pianists for, that you guys have literally a 9-foot long instrument, and whereas, you know, it's the violin is so small, to in order to fill a large space we have to work so much harder, right? I mean, it's just one of those things. But anyway, thanks for that, and thank you to the submission. So let's move on to the next one. We have here Eric, and Eric is only 14 years old. And he's about to play one of the movements from Petrushka.
Thank you.
That's very nice. Felt like it had a lot of characters and stuff like that, which is...
Yes, because Petrushka is this very sad and kind of comic character. And actually, you know what, Ray? This is originally written for ballet, as ballet music. Mm-hmm. But apparently Stravinsky wanted to write it as a piano concerto.
Ooh.
A piece for piano and orchestra, and then only... because Diaghilev, who was the impresario of the famous Ballet Russe group back then, he convinced him to actually make it a ballet music. But then Stravinsky made the piano arrangement himself, because I think back then they had to have like also piano arrangements for the rehearsal, because you wouldn't always have an orchestra from the beginning. But I like this very much. Oh my God, very. I've never played this piece.
I can't believe he's only 14 years old, right? Like
it's amazing.
It's like the dude made the piano look like pretty small of an instrument. I've always felt like the piano was this giant beast of an instrument, but it was like he was like just dominating it in the best way.
No, and I could really see Petrushka in front of my eyes, you know, being rejected by people looking for comfort, and then being heartbroken. And I think especially in this music, every note has to have like character and personality. And I thought this was a really, really wonderful rendition.
Yeah, you've done a lot of Stravinsky, really, right, amazing. Alice? I mean, I know that you did a Stravinsky project, right?
I did a project with Francesco Tristano. We called it Scandal, because it was basically back then, at that time, in the beginning of the 20th century in Paris, there was this Ballet Russe group which commissioned lots of great pieces, and great composers wrote for them. And so we took Sacre du Printemps by Stravinsky, and then combined it with Ravel's La Valse and some other pieces. So it was more about this group and about that time, and every performance back then was a big scandal, and people just rejected it. So it was an homage to a time. Actually, I have to say, Sacre du Printemps was actually the only piece I played by Stravinsky. So I have never really played. Yeah.
Okay. Well, but Stravinsky, yeah, because I thought about that. You know, we would make a good duo for the Divertimento.
We played Divertimento.
Yeah,
that's true.
We did do
that's
that
true.
One.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I was like, did that happen in a dream? Did I just only happening?
I remember. And actually, there were lots of Petrushka moments in that piece as well.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. It's a great piece. Yeah. Well, that's great to hear. And thank you, Eric, for your submission. I think
thank
that's
you.
So talented at such a young age. Let's move on to the next one. We have here, this is Sabrina, and Sabrina is 17 years old. She's playing the Chopin's Polonaise Fantasy, and this is going to start from the coda. Sorry, I'm going to start that again. This is going to start from the coda. Wow, that just started really soon.
Thank you.
I have some bad news. I did the echo thing again. So. No, it's because there were so many videos today and I was like handling this at such a last minute. I'm so sorry.
I'm super happy to listen again.
Okay, we gotta start it again. Oh gosh. I'm sorry, Alice. This is what happens. I was like, oh gosh. Okay, we got this. Okay, here we go. Sabrina, 17 years old, gonna play Chopin's Polonaise Fantasy.
Bravo. It's very nice. Very nice. It is such a wonderful piece. I mean, there's so much drama in there. It reminds me also a little bit of the Force ballade by Chopin. There's lots of similarities in there. Mm-hmm. And I mean, you can see there's so much going on and there's so many different like rhythms, characters, and It is such a hard piece to play as well. I mean,
yeah, there's a lot of notes, especially coming from a violinist like perspective. I think there was more notes in those 2 minutes than an entire violin piece. What would you say to Sabrina?
I think it's very well played. It's very, very well played. Lots of really nice things in there. I just have like one suggestion. I think that if you have that many notes and that much going on, I think it helps to differ between essential and elemental notes and melody lines, and then chords that, I mean, we all learn when we're students that every note is important and that we have to give a thought to every note. I mean, my teacher kept telling me this every time I had my lessons with him. But eventually, you know, notes play different roles, and especially when you have repetitive chords, then sometimes their job is to maybe just create a mood or an echo. And especially in the last two pages, there's so much going on and it's all very loud and emotional and forward driving. And I think it is important to see, okay, so what is now the important harmony how do I support the melody the best way? And I think there's a little bit of room for experiments and also improvement. And I think this is something I might want to suggest.
I see. Okay. Wow. Well, thank you for those words. I'm sure Sabrina.
Sorry, did it make sense what I said?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, in my violin brain, we only have to worry about, we have other things to worry about. Let's say intonation,
of course,
the
yeah.
sound, and everything. And sound is something I know pianists, you guys worry about as well. Just getting the right sound, you know, as they say, beginner violin sounds much worse, far, far worse than beginner piano. And when I'm listening to the music, when a pianist plays, so much of it, I feel like compared to when I listen to a violinist playing, I really can just enjoy the music of the pianist. I would say different aspects of it. I wouldn't say much more than the violinists, but I find myself a little bit more removed. So when I was listening to what you were talking about in terms of, you know, finding which notes were important, having a sort of structure of prioritizing which notes and which harmonies are important, it makes sense. It's just trying to then, in violin, you only have, let's say, 20 notes to choose from which one is taking priority.
Of course.
And whereas in piano, it's like you have 2,000 notes to choose from.
Right.
And I think that's what makes it difficult. Yeah.
Of course. I mean, look, we open the score and then there's this lots of, how do you call the babies of frogs? You know, the little black ones.
Tadpoles.
What? How?
Tadpole.
Tadpole?
Yeah, tadpole. Yeah, that's...
Oh, really? I learned something new. So, you know, it looks like a pond full of those.
Yeah, yeah.
And then you have to kind of, put an order into it and its structure and then find out, so what is important? What belongs to what? And it is lots of work, of course. And on top of it, you still have to play all of those. So it's alone, like learning the notes of such a piece is quite a challenge. But then, of course, put an order into it and then
make sense of
finding
it all.
Finding the right balance, I think, is then the next step.
Right.
But it's very impressive.
Right. Yeah, I do think that it equips pianists better to be able to think more about the entire structure of both a piece, but also when you play with, let's say, just the whole harmonic feeling is very is educated from a very young age as a pianist. Like when we were talking about piano facts, right? You have the entire orchestra, the entire range of the orchestra, from double bassoon to the highest note on the piccolo. Whereas on violin, I think that we don't think about what's going on in the harmony, or we just sort of intrinsically feel it. Some of us do. And then at some point we have to make all of that up, back up from our neglect from it. And then suddenly we have to try and figure out, oh wait, this harmony means what? So it seems to me that although piano is hard work in terms of that I can tell you on the other side, you have to learn that anyway to become a good musician. So, yeah.
But I mean, it, at the same time, you know, we learn so much from singers and violinists and like melody instruments, because sometimes, you know, you think too much and you think about the harmonies, how they relate to each other. And sometimes, you know, you have to step back and to actually look at the big picture. And of course, just like following the melody line helps very much. And I find myself very often stuck because I want to do something with the harmony. And then, you know, it's time to step back and to just look where the melody is heading.
Right. Well,
and sometimes it does not necessarily tell obviously the same story.
Yeah. That's well, you guys have that ability. I mean, that's what I think is so complex about the instrument, is that you can tell even contrary motion both in the hands but also in the in the story. One can be taking a theme from before, and the other one is the theme from the current time. So I think that's really cool. But anyway, let's move on. I think this one is going to be our last one before we move on to some other videos. Not the last video, but just the last playing video. We have here Kevin, who's 15 years old, and he's got his trio with him. So this is a bit of an unusual one. It's going to be playing Beethoven Trio Opus 11.
Really?
just gonna go ahead and just gonna take a deep breath. I'm gonna take a deep breath, and I guess, you know, maybe there is alcohol in this, and I don't even know.
I just wanted to suggest maybe you should drink alcohol. No, but it's lots of work to put all this together.
Yeah. We're just gonna take a moment and okay.
But the great thing about music is that you want to keep listening again and again.
Yeah,
and
yeah. This was all planned, and I just wanted to listen again. So, you know, it's enjoy it while you can. Enjoy it while you can. There, those of you in the chat. Oh boy. Okay, here we go. This is Kevin and his buddies. He's 15 years old playing the Beethoven Trio Opus 11. Thank you. Wow, great.
Nice. I like the way how they communicate with each other and don't just, focus on their
Oh
scores.
yeah, they're definitely
That's
having fun. Yeah.
very nice.
You could definitely see
Yeah,
that.
that's that. I think that's especially like when it comes to chamber music. That's what I always value so much, that there's apart from, all professionality, that there's so much fun you can have and react to each other and learn from each other.
Yeah.
And I like that he sent in this
Yeah, I know.
chamber
Yeah,
music
honestly, it
video.
makes me miss chamber music so much.
That's true.
Yeah, it really makes me play miss. I think that's the part of being quarantined that I miss the most. Yeah. Yeah, so.
That's true, and that you cannot replace in any way. I
Yeah.
mean, it's very difficult to make really chamber music and have this live experience.
Yeah.
When you like, I mean, I know that there are now like initiatives where you do different versions and people play in different places and put it together, but of course, it doesn't replace the live feeling of like sitting next to your friend and making music and speaking through music
Yeah, that's
together.
true. That's true. Anything that you would say to Kevin and his trio?
I really enjoyed this. Of course, there's like with Beethoven, there's always so much you can do and improve. And again, it was just a very short part. So I think again, for me, it's all about contrasts. And because he has, I think, in this piece already, already the fifth bar, there's a different dynamic. And I think this is something which is really, really important for Beethoven. So they could dare to like even go like really down with the volume and make this big contrast. This is what I always feel with Beethoven. When he writes a piano, I really want to play as soft as I can. And when he writes a forte, I think there should be this contrast. I don't know, what do you think?
Well, I think that granted, what you're saying is correct. If I may add a few things, I think that one of the things that I remember learning about in terms of playing with when you combine string instruments and piano together, which is kind of a string instrument, I mean, it's half string, half percussion, right? Is that, especially with Beethoven, that you always, as a string instrument, there's two sort of things that two different ways, mindsets you need to have. When you have the melody, when you know, like those kinds of things, it's melodic. But then when you have the like, yeah, all of that kind of
It's more,
accompanimental stuff, then you have to actually sound more like the piano. And you have to imagine that the piano can't go ta like that. And you cannot play violinistically anymore. You have to actually, a great example is, I've got my violin here actually. It's like, for example, the spring sonata. It when he writes here. So that's obviously very melodic, but then it's, you know. And then it goes into this, and that, so if you still play it like, then it's not right. You have to play it beautifully, but that
It has
somehow
to be, yeah.
I have to sound like how the piano would sound playing that.
Would
Yeah,
probably.
yeah, yeah.
While we have to imitate string instruments when we play this big line melodies.
Right.
So,
Do you think
the
about
because.
like, oh, how would this sound on a violin? Or do you think about more like voice?
Both, like it depends on the character, but I think there is a similarity to both, especially from our point, because I mean the piano in the end of the day it is a percussive instrument, but of course we want to make it sound, or we want to seem make it seem sound like a voice instrument or a string instrument, and so there are of course different techniques. But yes, I always try to learn from that and it is always a big challenge, because in the end of the day, it is a percussive instrument.
But I mean, I would say that when I listen to you play, and I think I'm gonna show you a couple of videos, guys, of Alice playing now. We've finally reached that moment. But when I listen to Alice play, I never think of the piano as a percussive instrument. So I'm gonna show you right now some of the stuff. We finally reached that moment, Alice, where we finished with reviewing the people's submitted videos. Now it's time to take a look at one of your videos. I found a couple that I want to share with everyone. And one is actually from quite a while ago, but the first one is actually Beethoven's piano concerto. And you know, it's out there on YouTube. You guys should definitely go check out Alice's links. They're all in the description below. So go check that out. And yeah, this one, I loved it, and there's two parts to this video I wanted to show you. But here's the first movement. Now I'm really scared that this is going to have the doubling, but I'm going to take a quick peek. Very, very nice. Are you trying to hide? I mean, why would you hide from your...
I really feel uncomfortable listening to my own play. Hey, I don't know how it is for you, but for example, when I do a recording, when I make a recording, I really listen intensely to it until I give my last okay.
Okay.
And then I never listen to it again. You know, I don't know. It's so weird to listen to myself. I don't know. I can you do it? Can you listen to yourself?
I try to listen. Every time I listen to myself, it's more, yeah, I know what you're feeling, that kind of, I actually hate doing it. But at the same time, I feel like I hate it because I think about all the things that I should, would have, could have, should have, you know? And, but then it also, I feel like listening to myself helps me grow, that every time if I think, oh, I could have done this better, that means that I have grown since then. And I think that's a good thing. So that's the way to, I think, approach listening. That's the way I try to approach listening to my own recordings. But it was pretty cute watching you, you were just trying to hide in your hands or something like that. But anyway,
because there's already million things I would want to do differently. So it's always this weird feeling.
Yeah. No, that's I totally get it. But actually, more importantly, from this performance, you know, I was so captivated. There's this one thing that you did, and it's funny. It's not particularly any notes that you played, or rather, it was the combination of the notes around this very moment of silence, in which you somehow just have this energy where you just you just, it's between the first and second movements. And I don't know if you remember this moment, feeling this moment, you were just like, you didn't raise out a hand, you know, we call that sacrilegious clapping. There was no clapping. There was maybe one tiny cough, but like the entire audience just like was just, you know, not doing anything. And then at that moment of tension, you just go boom. And then the most warm kind of like, oh, beautiful second movement chord that you can possibly imagine. So I want to show this to you just to refresh your memory, and then you can tell us about that moment. All right. So, okay, here we go. Yeah, that's what I'm talking about. That moment there where, okay, one person just had to cough, but other, like the tension was just there. And then you didn't let go of that tension. You kept it there, and then you released it in that first chord. Was that intentional? How do you practice? What is the mindset that goes through your head at that moment?
So the thing is, this concerto, it's actually one of, like, it's his only concerto which is written in minor. It is in C minor, and the second movement is in E major, and C minor and E major couldn't be further apart. You know, it's a really wide reach. They're not really related, but I was always thinking about, you know, because this E major is almost like a prayer, you know, it ends in this very, very dark and very emotional a mood. And then the second movement starts in this, you know, very warm tone. And I was always thinking about how could I really get into this mood if, like, everybody is going to relax in between. And then, of course, once the musicians on stage relax, then the audience relax as well. And then it's very, very difficult to get into this mood of and into this chord. And usually, you know, there's no moment anymore without a cough or anything to start. You know, it's very difficult to find this moment to start with a chord. You know, because once the coughing starts, then it goes on, and it's very difficult to catch this moment. And I've talked to conductors about this, and then you know, it also comes from the thought that I think there shouldn't be any rules in concert halls. I think especially in classical music, in concert halls, there are so many rules and people get stiff. And I also think that why people cough in between movements is because they think that's the only moment where they're allowed to make some noises.
Right.
Because otherwise, you know, people look at them. Or even if you cough in between or clap in between movements, other people in the audience go like, shh, And I really don't like that because that person who clapped did this because he felt or they felt like this. And it's a spontaneous reaction and they shouldn't be judged for it. But if we don't want it to happen because of the music that is connected, then I think it's the responsibility of the performer. And that's why, I mean, of course, each time I play this piece, I talk to the orchestra and the conductor because I need their support as well. It's not enough if just, like, right, if it's just right, me who's, yeah. who's trying to create this.
Yeah.
So everybody has to do it because especially if, like, there's 80 people on stage, the orchestra musician, then they relax or turn pages, then this is a sign that there is everybody can relax. And so I think that if you don't want the audience to clap, it is, as a performer, it is your responsibility to communicate that. Mm-hmm. And I don't believe in communicating that by either, you know, just standing up and leaving stage or telling them to not clap. But I think you can either, for example, in my recitals, I like to play everything together as if it was one big experience. And I talk in the beginning about the concept. And I have actually experienced the most supportive audiences so far. And I think also performers on stage, we sometimes underestimate the audience. And I think if you motivate the audience to be part of it, then they feel so much more supportive. And if you either show it this way, then everybody understands it. And then when it works, they also feel like they're a part of it.
Yeah.
I mean, that's how I see it.
They're part of your performance.
And they're a part of it. And we, because it is like this, because I think the audience is a very important part of a live performance. Without them, we would not be able to deliver the same performance. And also, they're part of the acoustic.
Right.
No, we it's our Absolutely. It's our responsibility as artists to create the sound that's fits the acoustic and the environment the best. And so the audience is an important part of the story. Mm. And so this is a topic that been bothering me a lot because, you know, in some concert halls I've seen the programs and there's this list of what you're not supposed to do.
Mm.
And I really don't like that. I think especially if you are young and if you come the very first time to a concert and if you see a page full of instructions you're not allowed to do, you don't want to go again.
Yeah.
And
I see someone in the chat basically just said, you know, there's a fine line, and I agree with this, a fine line between compelling people to, you know, not to clap or to clap, and then enforcing silence, right?
Mm.
You're compelling them with what you say, what you just said now was just a sheer, and you can't do it alone. That's what I admire so much about what you just said, is that you need every single person on stage. This didn't come... That's why it's so powerful, because you have 80 something musicians all with their musical energy just making that tension. And I think that that's such a, that must have been so captivating in the, I wish I was in that hall. I mean, we can feel it through the camera. I can only imagine what it must have been, especially as the performer as well. So that's really cool.
You know, my teacher, he always used to say music is not just about the notes you play. It's about the silence in between the notes, the space in between the notes. And I think also in, like, even if you have 1, 2, 3 movements, sometimes they're really connected. And especially in this concerto, for me, this was the only way to make this transition from C minor to E major possible. I don't know how I will be thinking about this in 10 years, but I like this challenge, and so far it has actually worked. I mean, it never happened that the audience clapped, and this way you also see that actually, you know, they really want to be part of it and they want to be supportive. It's just because there are so many rules, and they, like, some people really feel nervous at concerts and they feel stiff, and also those ones who know the movements, they know, okay, when to clap and when not to clap.
Right.
But I think this should be like a live event, and it should come from stage, the performers, and then they are part of it, and they automatically do what we do.
Right. Yeah. I mean, it's interesting. I was thinking from the C minor to that E major. Maybe it's because, you know, you can land. You have to fall from into, you know, you mentioned even the motion of, you said starting. It's impossible to start. You cannot, like, start like this. You'd have to bring up the energy to come back down again. But it's much easier to keep it there and then just let it kind of go.
Because it ends like ba-bam, ba-bam, and then, you know, it's not the end.
Yeah.
In my eyes, it's not right. The end. So, like, it goes somewhere. We just don't know where it goes. And then when it comes to this E major, it's like,
whew. Right. So maybe the clapping, no clapping, it really then depends on which piece you're playing. Maybe it's repertoire specific.
Yes, I mean, right? Yes, of course. Like, for example, the Tchaikovsky Piano Concerto, I've played it so many times, and it happened that after the first movement, people started clapping. And that's okay, because it is a natural reaction. And then I find it actually not really, I don't like when people then go like, shh, it's still the first movement.
Right, right.
And because that's a natural reaction, and that's okay.
Maybe, you know,
the arc. Yeah.
I'm going to start thinking more about your words, about what you say, because yes, like the Tchaikovsky Violin Concerto, it's just made.
Or the Tchaikovsky,
or the Piano Concerto.
Yeah, made, yeah.
It's the first, after the first movement, if you don't clap, it feels almost strange. So maybe it's about letting everyone feel, and first that's starting with everyone on stage and planning that and being like, hey guys, so this is going to be, we're going to finish it with a greater flourish. We want people to have that reaction. That's where the energy goes. It goes up, or it goes like tense, or it goes, you know, down, like that. Each thing has a plan, because I mean, we plan the rest of the piece. We study it intensely. That's how you achieve depth. Without planning, there's no depth. I mean, then the extra stuff comes in, but that's only, you know, the 2%. That's what creates the final magic. But the planning is what creates all that depth. And then finally, yeah, why not the last note? So I really enjoyed what you just said. I'm going to really think about that the next time I walk on that stage.
No, because the thing is, Ray, especially when somebody comes the very first time to hear you, you know, I've had debates with colleagues and friends about if it's only the music that's important. And very often I hear the opinion that it only is all about the music and it's not about the visuals. But I disagree, because the moment you put your foot on stage, that's when the audience get the first impression. And I think everything is part of the whole performance, like in opera and in other genres. But it's not just the music you play and the notes you play. I think the whole thing is you tell a whole story. And so I think also the way how you come on stage, it doesn't need to be played or performed. But I think that also plays a role. And so also the space in between pieces or in between movements play, in my eyes, play a big role. And that's why nowadays I believe more and more in concerts that have, for example, with my last recital program, I combined everything. So for me, it was not only anymore about all those single pieces, but it was a whole experience. It was a whole story. And there's so much more we can do with this, because, for example, also with lighting, I'm changing the lighting according to the mood of the program. There's so much more we can do, and it's sometimes really a little bit sad to see that still classical concerts are done in a very normal standard way, while technology is so advanced and we could do so much more.
We're here using technology. I think things will change. After, it just takes time. I think that classical music is steeped in tradition, and I think it's difficult to, because you get things always on the flip side where it's like, no, I did not mean that when I said, you know, a certain thing. Someone always inevitably takes it to where it's way over the line, right? And then you're just like, no, I didn't say, I'm open to technology, but did I say people ought to be using cell phones during concerts? No. No, I never said that. Mm. You know, stuff like that. Not that anyone's ever quoted me on saying that, but as an example, I think that those things are, you know, we have to, and I think that comes with, we have to educate everyone at the same rate there before we can, or set examples like yourself, what you said with your recitals. I remember going to your recital in Berlin and, you know, seeing what you did with the lighting. So Elise does this, you know, I haven't seen the latest album yet, but this was the one before, or was it Nightfall?
Before, yeah, when... No, it was, I think it was Wonderland, but when I started experimenting with different options.
Yeah. And you know, I just thought that I've always felt like, yeah, we have a traditional way of going to concerts, but then at Alice's concert, at your concert, Alice, I felt like it was what you said earlier, that word, an experience. And that made me, that really inspired me. When I went there, I felt like, it was like, yeah, it wasn't just like, oh, I'm here to hear the notes. No, I'm here to feel the notes and feel the atmosphere and get into this other world. You know, when they say music transports you to another place, I could really feel that with the aid of that. So that was something really cool. I mean, I have to admit that at the beginning, I was thinking, is this going to, you know, you always feel the cringe factor. Like, is this necessary? Yeah. Because you're used to a certain way. And so therefore go in with prejudice, right? You think like, oh no, this surely is not going to help the music. It's only going to get in the way. But then I think when you actually, that's on you, the listener. I felt like once I was able to let go of myself, then I could truly enjoy music. And I think that's what's really wrong with, or what needs to change a little bit. Sorry to get so serious about this, but this is, I'm really enjoying this conversation, is that classical music needs to almost allow itself to enjoy certain things. It needs to allow itself to go online. It needs to allow itself to clap or not clap between movements, or, you know, what about a particular artist, give an opinion about a particular piece. And that's really interesting.
I think, like, you know, when we talk about tradition, I think it is inevitable, and it is really essential that we really, you know, take apart the score, and that we really study the score. We know what the composer wants. But apart from that, like, times are changing. We are changing. It's not anymore like 50 years ago or 100 years ago. And I think the composers, they have written this music not just for their time, but they were anyway ahead of their time. And I think music is timeless. Yeah. And a Beethoven is not old music. It is music we live now. We listen to it now. We feel it now. So it is here and now. And so why shouldn't we actually adjust to the time we live in? I mean, it doesn't mean that we shouldn't take the music seriously and the message of the composer. I mean, this is what we all do, and that's why we practice, and we study the score over and over again. But the way of performing, I think, should be contemporary. I mean, that's my opinion.
And, I agree 100%. Yeah. I think that what you're saying is right. Yeah.
So, and that's why, you know, I love also how much now it is changing. And I'm also seeing you, like, you really communicate with your audience, and you let them feel that you're not different, any different than them. You make them feel that they're part of it, and you share something. And I think this is what music is about. It's not about the difference between the performer and the audience. It's about the similarity.
Yeah, yeah. Well, thanks. It's you know, it's really well said. Really well said. And you know, thanks for those comments as well. I think it's trust as well. Trust plays a huge part into it.
Oh, definitely.
When you trust the performer, when you trust the artist. Because they're kind of taking you on a musical journey, right? On the stage.
Yes, of course.
That,
yes.
you then will, it allows you to sort of relax and then experience it, what we were just both talking about, in the best, in a fresh and best possible way. Yeah. So that's really great. But so I want to move on to the next video. No, this is great. I love it. And people in the chat are loving it too. You know, it's everyone's really enjoying this.
I don't see the comments.
Oh yeah, I'm reading it as it's going along. So no worries. That is happening. Let's move on to the next. I found a really young Alice online. I think you are 19. You're playing the only 19 years old, and you're playing this La Campanella list. Are you 19? Does this ring a bell?
Yeah, I think so. Yeah.
You're like, what are you going to show?
I have long hair.
You do have long hair. Yes, that's right. And
before I cut my hair.
and I this looks like it was taken in a studio. It looks like it was live as well. So, you're playing La Campanella, and I just thought it was so awesome. And I wanted to share that with everyone. So here we go. This is... Oh, and that last bit where you're just like, you just do the rah like that. Like, even though it... I mean, technically it doesn't make a sound, right? On the piano, but...
No, it doesn't.
But it just... It stops the sound. So you made it stop the sound, but with such... force that was equal to the force you put in, and I thought that was really cool. Yeah, wow. Guys, and if you want to hear, if you want to listen to the original, like, the recording is on YouTube. There's two versions. There's actually like a lower resolution one and then a higher resolution one. You should go listen to the higher resolution one. It is insane. And I think that this was actually done. Correct me if I'm wrong. It's you were recording an album, but instead of just like you actually re-recorded this part for the video. Is that right? Like, this is all live.
Yeah, this had to be. It was quite challenging because it had to be one take live. Back
then. So it's a one take.
Yes. Nice. Yes. It is. This is a piece I started playing when I was 12 years old, it's not true. I was 10 years old because my first teacher was Hungarian, and I don't know, he was crazy enough to give me this piece, or maybe I was crazy enough to ask for this. Back in those days when I like to play pieces that were fast and loud. But no, I was actually, you know, the thing is, so I had a crush on Liz. I always thought he was a handsome man, and until one day.
No problem. It's just a crush on Liz, you know. Like,
oh my God, what was that?
I have a crush on Alice. That's the. That's...
Did you never have a crush on a dead person? Okay, this sounds creepy. No, sorry. Did you ever have a crush on a person who has lived
in another time?
Or like
admire?
Or like really find that person. I mean, I found Liz good looking.
I think Clara Schumann. Clara Schumann would
be... Really?
Yeah, because she. It's because of her that we're all memorizing music nowadays. And you know, she she was so
like a role model.
Yeah, she was like so ahead of her time, and you know, she was a performing artist, like one of the few women performing artists of like up until that moment. And so she was the first performing artist to go on stage without music. I mean, really, without it. Because even Mozart, you know, we all know that story where there was Leopold, King, Emperor, or whatever, and he was like, he had like just sheets of paper. But no, Clara was just like, I'm going to go on stage, and this is how it is. And, you know, and she still had to take care of the kids. She still had to, like, you know, take care of Robert, because Robert had psychological problems. And then, like, then of course there's all Brahms thing and Brahms and her, like Brahms pining after her, and yet she was like, as far as history tells, is like, was pretty true and like was not. She never ended up with Brahms. She was just like, no, I'm just gonna be myself. I'm gonna be my own person, and I think that that's really admirable. It just to me, yeah, shows that I felt like shows like such maturity and knowing who you really are. So yeah, if I had to choose a dead person to have a crush on, it would be Clara Schumann.
You have a better story than me, because mine was oh my god, like, okay, he actually, because of Liszt, we have the pianos we have nowadays, because he was totally revolutionizing also the instrument piano, because he was inventing techniques that were not possible back then on the older
Basically like Paganini, right?
Yeah, after like, yeah, right, he experienced a live performance of Paganini and decided to become Paganini on the piano. And because of him, we have lots of different techniques now. But it was not just that. It was just, you know, when I saw his photos and heard his stories, apparently he was a big womanizer as well. And he was like a pop star. And but then one day when I was, I don't know how old I was, I had the honor to play on the instrument of it's Richard Wagner's who's his son-in-law instrument, and also the Liszt had performed on this piano, and so I had the honor to play
that's really cool
short recital on it in Bayreuth, and next to this Haus Wahnfried, which is Wagner's house, there is the house where Liszt had passed away, and it was a Liszt museum at that time. And of course, there are lots of things that belong to him. And there was also a window where his shoes were displayed. And so I was super excited. And then I found his shoes and I had to realize that my feet are bigger than his.
Oh!
So that was like the moment where
yeah. That's pretty funny. That's pretty funny.
So yeah, because of course people were much shorter at that time.
Yeah.
So I figured he was shorter than me, and that I did not find cool back then.
All of this, you know, it's all good. I'm sorry I you know, gave such good reasoning behind me, you know, simping for Clara Schumann, which made you feel like you had to justify, when in fact, I mean, let's face it, you just liked him because he was hot and talented. I get that.
Yeah.
Liszt is, you know, yeah, yeah, cool. It's
no,
good,
but
good choice. Good choice for a pianist.
Well, I think that there's so much potential in his music. Very often it's just seen as, you know, music fireworks, but actually there's lots of depths in it. And I think the challenge of playing this music is to play it so that it seems easy.
Right.
I think that's really the biggest challenge, this effortlessness. Mm-hmm. But anyway, I noticed I was wearing shoes, so that's quite a while ago, this performance.
Yeah, well, I thought it was amazing, and mad respect to you, to 19-year-old Alice, and current you, of course. Is there anything, just before we move on to some questions, is there anything that, like, you feel that, hey, you look back, not that it wasn't already an awesome performance, but how would you play it differently now? I'm just curious, like, what would be different about it?
I mean, first of all, I haven't played this piece in years because this used to be my encore piece.
Oh.
But this is, you know, the thing, when you are in the beginning of your 20s, you like to play these kind of pieces as an encore. And nowadays, I feel more like I need something to really calm down and to calm down also after a recital, because usually I get really emotional. So I nowadays I somehow choose pieces that are more like softer and more like a lullaby. And I used to always play this piece. So this is one thing. Feel like playing campanella anymore, except
it's not your vibe anymore these days. It's you're more in the
no
kind of chill vibe.
Yeah, it's also it shows to me, you know, for example, this was when I recorded all the 12 transcendental etudes by Liszt, and I'm very, very happy I did it back then, because I would not do it again. I would not play these etudes anymore, because now, and that shows me also how I've changed as a person. And I think also after this, and between now and then, there was a long path of search, and there were some years where I would not really know who I am as an artist, as a person. And I think now I have reached a point where I know pretty well what I want to do, how I want to be as an artist. And so when I look back, you know, it's very nostalgic. And like, of course, there are millions of things I would want to tell myself, how, like, what to do differently. But then again, I think I had to make mistakes to kind of get where I am right now. I mean, how do you think when you look at pictures of yourself, or like even see yourself in performance 10 years ago?
Well, 10 years ago was, you know, I was enjoying life on the road. I was, you know, there was more of me to love, perhaps. I was a little, well, just, you know.
Oh, it's true. I saw this one picture of you with the cowboy hat. Can you not show it now?
I could perhaps arrange that. But first, we're gonna go. I asked Alice what her a couple of her favorite things on YouTube were, just so we could watch them together. And Alice is a food aficionado, much like myself. Although I partake in smaller quantities of food these days, than I did 10 years ago. But this is what she came up with. This is an omelet, a Japanese omelet video that is apparently, it's very difficult to make. Is that right, Alice? It's like...
Yes, very difficult.
Okay. All right. So apparently, you know, this guy making this omelet is a genius, and I just can't tell. So here we go. I'm going to watch this. Which one is it? Oh gosh. Okay, so we can talk over this one. This is
okay.
What is that? Is that seaweed?
I mean, this is noriya, seaweed. And he's making something called dashimasu tamago. We call it tarako. It's like botaga. It's fish roe.
Oh, it's fish roe. That's the pink stuff.
Yeah, the pink stuff, exactly. And he put it in, he rolled it, and dashi maki tamago means, dashi is broth, and maku is like rolling. And so they roll it like this, and it's fluffy, it is tender, it's a little bit sweet, a little bit salty, and it just melts in your mouth. It is. Have you ever seen Dreams of Jiro? What was it called? Dreams of Sushi? No.
I'm
Do you salivating. Remember this documentary?
Jiro Dreams of Sushi, yeah.
Yeah, exactly. And there's this one person who is just making the omelet. So it's an art.
Yeah. Oh, gosh.
To make omelet. I mean, also normal omelet is pretty difficult to make.
This was such a bad idea, Elise. Why are we watching this?
You're getting hungry, right?
Oh my gosh.
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
This is one thing I always order in Japan.
Why did we have to watch that and not have any food? Like, what the heck?
I'm so sorry.
Okay. And then you said, okay, so that was inspiring, because apparently it's very difficult to make. But then you said that another thing that you really like is these, like, auditory illusions.
Wait, before we move on, okay. Ray, you are a foodie, no? So don't you agree that like the emotions you feel when you eat something really, really good and hear good music, that they're kind of similar?
I feel immense happiness when I'm eating ice cream, and
not just the ice cream.
Yeah,
there's other,
like, other foods as well. Yeah, I definitely. Yeah, if we're okay, since we're all right, we're gonna talk about this. We're gonna talk about this then. So
I'm sorry.
I love food. I really do. It's like my favorite thing, and I have a problem with it because I always feel like there's not enough food, right? So every time I go out to eat with my parents at the restaurant, we always fight. Why? Because, well, these days they've learned, because I look at the menu and I say, I want this. And my mom just, like, she just hates it because she doesn't like wasting food. But I say, we can take it home. But because then we can get, like, extra, right? I can get extra. Because, oh, gosh. And now that I'm finally old enough, you know, my biggest dream, my, like, it wasn't to become, like, incredibly wealthy or something, or, like, world-famous. My biggest dream was just to be able to, okay, travel the world and earn it just enough money where I could eat whatever I wanted. That's my...
Look how emotional you are.
I didn't want to get into this live stream, but there it is. And
well,
that's, yeah, yeah. So that's all. That's all.
I remember we went to some amazing restaurants, and I remember these moments when we put, like, if it was a piece of meat or a piece of fish or whatever in our mouth, and this, like, moment where everybody goes like, and I think this is also, this happens, like, I sometimes have, like, almost, like, goosebumps when I eat sushi, for example, in Japan. And this reminds me of, like, moments when you feel that, like, there's this unity in music.
Yeah, yeah, it's... Yeah, I feel a little bit too much unity with food. We've got people in the chat talking about how we're going to do a mukbang. Don't tempt me. maybe one of these days a mukbang stream. We should do that. We should just, like, order a lot of food and then just eat it. And then just be like, hey, guys, what's up? Let's just eat. Apparently, that's, like, a thing on YouTube. I'm new to YouTube. So, I mean, I've had my account for a while. Oh, by the way, Alice has a YouTube as well, so go like and subscribe on her videos as well as her Instagram. She uses that a lot, and yeah, she's like, do I use that a lot? Yes, you do. Alice uses it a lot.
I do. Yes. I do. Yeah. Instagram. Yeah.
Yeah. And so, you know, go check out her stuff if you're just joining us now. But yeah, okay, food. Yes, we are both foodies, and it's part of the best part about being a musician. In fact, I mean, besides the music, of course, and the people. And the lovely people, but it's the food, you know.
Yes, there is good food. That's great true. Food. It is true.
Okay.
Hey, sometimes. Oh, sorry. One more thing. Sometimes when I actually play something, you know how you connect music to things you have experienced. It sometimes food pops up my mind, you know, and I like can recall this exact place, the exact food I've eaten, and the exact flavor and like smell.
Oh wow! You have basically what is that called? Photographic food memory. You can instant recall.
I've never heard that.
Yeah, well, it's when like people can have photographic memory. It's just like when you can, you know, you read a page.
Yeah, I know, but there is such a thing, really?
Okay. We just made it up right now. You just declared that to everyone, that you have photographic food memory. And you know, we've got
one talent.
Thank you. We suddenly had a flurry of donations in the chat for food. So thanks to Lotte and KH for their donations for food. Basically, there's enough donations from the stream for us to go and buy ice cream. So
yeah, next time you.
Yeah, I owe you ice cream, Alice. Okay.
Yes.
May I move on to the next thing?
Yes, of course. I'm sorry. Yes.
Thank you. I'm so thank sorry. You. Yes, I will do as you command. I mean, this is your stream now. This is Offstage with Alice Sara Ott, not Offstage with Ray Chen. So I'm just the operator here. I operate this thing. Would you like it to be on you? I can do that. I can do that more. I also have the cool sexy jazz thing.
Oh, that's nice.
Yeah, that's something that I can do as well. And okay, never mind. Anyway, we are moving on to the what do we have? Oh, yes. I asked Alice what her favorite, like, other favorite stuff was, and it was like auditory illusions, which is basically when you hear, like, Alice likes puzzles, right? I've seen you do your Rubik's Cube stuff. And I guess this is like a puzzle that we can all partake in. And this one is like, so certain words sound different to certain people. So there was this famous Yanny versus Laurel thing. And let's just, like, that's one example. We'll just play that right now. For example, this. Which one do you hear?
Laurel. 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 Laurel.
Well, first say what you think.
Laurel. Laurel.
Well, I always hear Yanni. I just don't hear
Laurel. Do you hear that still now?
Yes, I still hear Yanni.
Laurel.
Can you not hear Laurel?
I hear Yerny, something like that.
Laurel.
But I never hear Laurel.
Laurel.
Do you hear Laurel?
Laurel.
I hear both. But before...
Oh my god, you're a genius.
Before, when I was younger... When I was younger, I heard more Yanni. And now... So, okay. People in the chat are saying... Okay. We got...
Where
did
they speak?
It's like half-half.
Really? It's like the dress. You remember the dress?
Yeah.
Did you see white and gold, or did you see blue and black?
Well, it depends, because that was like, there were different shadings of it, and some were obviously blue and black, and others were white and gold. So.
No, I saw in all of them blue and black.
Oh, really? Okay, so.
Yeah.
I looked into this, and people who can hear Yanni hear the higher frequencies. Mm-hmm. And people who hear Laurel hear only like more of the lower frequencies because they can't hear the higher frequencies, which in fact means that you have boomer ears. So I'm in progression. I'm in like the mid state between having young ears and boomer ears. So there you have it. So yeah, older people would hear Laurel more.
Okay, why do I feel like this is not necessarily a compliment?
A what? It's backed by science. I have science on my side, so do not refute the science. No, I...
Okay, so do you have...
I have a few more.
One
okay.
More?
Okay. Maybe one or two more. Let's see. Okay, so the next one is... Okay, I'm headphones alert because it's a little bit loud. This one is basically where they say one word over and over again. It's called priming. And we're shown different photos. So they say something that sounds like Bill, but then it'll sound like Mayo, and then it'll sound like Bale, and yeah, stuff like that. So check this out. All right.
Are you not spoiling it?
No, not at all, because this is how it goes.
Okay.
Yeah. It changed, right? It totally changed.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I heard Bale, but I never heard Mayo.
You never heard Mayo? Did you hear Pale? No. Like Pale, like a pail of water?
No, it was always in between Bill and Bale.
Oh, okay. All right. Maybe that one's for like English speakers that have...
No, okay,
because I was like thinking, oh, as I was watching, I was like, Pale? Like that's why I had to say the words before as well. Because maybe no one says pail of water anymore, unless you're like talking about that rhyme, that nursery rhyme. Jack and Jill went up the hill to fetch a pail of water. You know? Do you know that?
I didn't know this.
Oh,
one.
Oh, Jack
no.
fell down and broke his crown, and Jill came tumbling after.
Oh. Yeah,
so that's where I first heard the word pail of water. So, okay, that was a bad one. That was a bad one. We're gonna, okay, this one you'll enjoy. Okay, so this one is a piano one. So basically what someone did was they got the Bee Gees song and, you know, stay alive, stay alive.
Mm-hmm.
And that one, oh God, my singing is so terrible. And they converted it all to MIDI piano. So there are no lyrics, okay? But yet somehow we hear lyrics.
Yes,
okay,
yes.
All right, here we go. You're excited. I'm excited too.
Okay,
my gosh. I was just thinking, like, if someone just, like, went into the stream right now. But, okay, I went and subtitled it, okay? And now you can hear the words. Crazy?
It is. It is.
Yeah, yeah.
I've seen a similar video once too, and it really sounds like it sounds like words. It's incredible.
Yeah, it's pure MIDI. There's actually, I mean, as far like everyone on the video is like pianos, as far as we know, don't talk. But there's something about that, and I think it's like so incredible that, you know, certain pieces we play it more spoken. I'm sure you've like heard that, like had that thought before, and certain pieces are more lyrical, right? More sung.
Yeah.
And I was just thinking, gosh, that is right there. Mm. I mean, in an ironic or roundabout way of basically, yeah, that is the very definition of something being spoken.
Yeah. It's crazy. Wow.
Yeah.
Yeah. So I like to watch these kind of videos.
Nice. Nice. Thank you for introducing us to this and myself as well. I had heard of a couple of them, like the Yanni versus Laurel one, but yeah, didn't really look into that many of those. So that was really cool. We have some time for some Ask Alice questions. So here we have. First up, I'm really curious to know, how fast can you type? Have you found the agility and dexterity developed by playing piano to be useful in any other aspects of your life?
So the typing thing is actually really embarrassing because I'm one of those who types like this. Oh. I'm pretty fast, but I still do.
But you're not utilizing your full powers. You're only using like 20%.
No, and then the other bizarre thing is I realized the other day, so I cannot dance at all. I have a coordination problem because I was trying to do because we're all locked at home. So I was trying to do some sports, some workout, and I cannot follow instructions.
You mean like...
When you have to... like do some certain movements.
Is it like the hand-eye coordination? Like your hand-eye coordination, we call that in English. Is that like catching a ball, throwing a ball?
Yeah, yeah. I was always so bad at ball games. Okay. And do you know dodgeball?
Yeah,
you remember dodgeball?
Yeah, of course.
So I was always the one who was chosen, like the last one who was chosen. So basically, if you had to play with me, it was you were going to lose. And I was also the first one to be kicked out, and I never made it back into the field.
So we have a lot of people in the chat relating right now. We got a lot of people.
Oh, good. I'm not alone.
Can you please do that one more time so we could just see it? You're not alone.
Oh, you did not see. I'm not alone.
You're not alone.
No. Oh, thank you very much. Thank you. It was it was not a winning pose, but anyway, what I realize is because probably I have hyperactive fingers. Okay. That's something I have from playing the piano.
Okay.
That's probably why I do like the Rubik's cube and origami, because I have to do. I don't know if it's like something positive, but
it's interesting because on the other hand, you would think that you would have immense hand-eye coordination as a musician, yet so many musicians suck at sports. So I don't really know if that's just a familiarity thing. I am actually reasonably
good
at sports. Yeah, but I think that was also because I didn't want to be one of those like Asians that was bad at sport. You know, I didn't want to be a stereotype. Growing up in Australia, I fought really hard against that so that I wouldn't, you know, because, you know, look, I'm not saying that like...
But aren't they usually good at sports?
Asians? I think that there are two types of Asians.
Yeah.
I think that...
Okay, what
that you either have like the nerd Asian or you have like, yeah, a smaller percentage is like the sporty Asian. But that was in Australia. I'm not so clued in as to, I think that there are more types of Asian in America, like to be honest, because the wave of immigrants came over like far earlier than they did in Australia. But back in Australia, we had like maybe just, it was just very, you know,
Don't take on your Australian accent.
What's wrong with my Australian accent? What's wrong with my accent?
No, but this is my normal accent. I know, but it is so weird when you, like, I remember when you made a reservation in a restaurant in London and you suddenly started speaking British English and it was so awkward because I've met you speaking American English and it was like, whoa, it's another person.
Was a little bit cringy? Do you find my Australian accent a little bit cringy, Elise? are you getting the same goosebumps from when you have sushi in Japan?
Not exactly the same ones. But sorry, I interrupted.
No. We're going to move on to the next question. Do you believe in playing difficult pieces above your skill level to learn new skills, or just because you love a piece and really want to try it, or is it better to stick to your current level and skills until your teacher or someone thinks you're ready? It like basically tells you to play.
I think it is always important to aim for something higher because that's how you grow.
To push yourself a little bit.
Yeah, to push yourself. Mm-hmm. But what I also learned throughout these years is that sometimes you also have to accept your limits or like the limit at a certain time. It very much depends on. I mean, of course, obviously, as a child, I always wanted to play the difficult and the bigger things. And I remember once I had a big fight with my teacher because I was 12 and I wanted to play the B flat. I always get confused. B flat minor scherzo by Chopin. And he thought I was too young for it. Mm-hmm. But I would not, so I really pushed for it. And so after like 10 discussions, he finally gave in and he said, okay, you can start learning it, but it won't be easy. And it actually really took 3 years until he approved my play.
Oh, wow.
I mean, it was not, yeah, so it was, it really, it was a big challenge, but I think I learned a lot. So I think pushing your limits is an important thing. But at one point, you have to also realize where you are. And I think especially being a musician and being on the road and also playing concerts, at one point, you have to really get to know yourself and know what you can do and where there's a limit.
Mm.
I mean, we've talked about this once. No?
Yeah,
about
we did.
For example, the number of what is healthy, and I think it changes also. I think the definition of happiness, the definition of career, all these things change. But I think it's important to constantly listen to yourself and to really, really know what you need and what your body needs, what your soul needs.
Right.
And I think it's also the same with playing pieces above or at your level. Mm.
Very nice. Very well said. Was there a certain moment or event that suddenly changed your perspective on music and made you more passionate about it?
Well, there are lots of moments. It can be like small, unimportant moments or some moments on stage that change things. But it definitely the last 2-3 years were changed a lot in the way how I see things and how I reflect on things, because first of all my dad had a heart attack and no, you don't call it a heart attack, how do you say it in English?
A stroke.
No, a stroke I think is in the brain, no? Because when it happens to your heart,
it's a heart attack.
A heart attack? Yeah. Okay. And I also got diagnosed with MS. So like these kind of things change, of course, the way how you see, especially how you experience darkness and how you experience light. Yeah. But actually, I mean, I think I for myself turned it into a very positive direction.
Right.
It would change the way how I feel things. And mm-hmm. I think I don't take things for granted. This is the one thing I learned.
That's
and of course,
great.
It would also influence the way how I play.
That's great. Oh, wow. Mm. We're going to have some question music in the background as we move on to the next question.
Okay.
All right. So vibe with me, guys. This is something new I'm trying. Let me know in the chat if you like it or not. And just forget about it in the meantime. Classical music fashion. Your clothing choice for performances is distinctly different to other pianists. Do you feel that by dressing in a room, in a more modern, do you feel like, by dressing in a more modern style, okay, I'm going to turn that off. I am getting distracted. Do you feel that by dressing in a more modern style, it will bring younger people into the world of classical music and, you know, kind of get rid of the stuffy old man image? Also, do you get your outfits custom made?
Yeah, I decide what to wear based on the mood of the program. So for example, when I play Beethoven's third piano concerto, it is a very dark piece, so I would not wear red or gold or something. And also for my recitals, I usually go for one outfit. I don't believe in rules and dress codes in concert halls, as I already said, and I think everyone should wear something they feel comfortable with. I, for example, feel comfortable being barefoot, so I'm always barefoot.
Yeah, that's like
and
one
I
of
also
your things,
walk.
Right? It's like,
yeah.
It's a very Alice thing.
Yeah. It started because I had to play on a historical instrument where I could not put my knees under the keyboard because of the high heels I used to wear.
Mm-hmm.
And then I just thought, okay, I'm always at home. I mean, are you barefoot at home?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, lots of Asians are, no? Because we have this...
The
tradition to not wear shoes.
But, I mean, we wear slippers at home. We wouldn't wear slippers out.
Oh, you do?
Yeah, I wear slippers. Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Nice. Well, maybe you should start performing in slippers.
Performing in slippers? I feel like, you know, for me, it's important to wear dress shoes because it makes me feel very, you know, that it's an event. If I felt too comfortable, I don't think I would summon the same kind of like the same chi, you know, or whatever, the same energy on stage that I would because it's a performance. Yeah. I don't know. Maybe I should try it. Or maybe I would just, it would just kind of make things more relaxed and comfortable and it would balance things out. I don't know. I think it's weird for a guy to not, to go on. The ladies can cover their, like, I mean, I don't know. This is the thing. Even if I wanted to go on stage barefoot, I don't think I'd be allowed to.
Why wouldn't you? Why wouldn't you? I mean, that's the thing, what I said. But I think, no, you should wear what you want to wear on stage. And that's my point. I also want my audience to come to my concert the way they want to. Like, they should sit the way they want, they should be dressed the way they want. And everybody, like, there are some people who really like to dress up, and I find that nice too, but I also want people to be able to come in jeans and t-shirt or in shorts or something.
Yeah.
And but for me, it has to, for like for myself, it has to match the music and the mood I am in.
Yeah.
And if I get my outfit custom made, and no, I usually buy things I like if I can afford them. Right now, I'm into sewing, so let's see. Maybe I can come up with my own outfits. I don't
know. Very nice. Very nice indeed. Okay, I think we have time for one last question. Oh my gosh, we've been on the stream for 2 hours, guys. 2 hours.
Oh,
you're breaking.
I'm so
you're breaking new records. Is your drink empty by now?
Yeah, my drink is empty. But Ray, you still have the power to just kick me out.
No, I'm your mirror operator. I do as you command. I mean, this is, if the chat wants more, we just, I mean, technically it's a stream. People just join and leave when they want. They don't have to watch the whole
right.
thing. You know, actually people who stream like on Twitch, this other platform, they stream for like six hours a day, 6 to 8 hours.
Wow.
Yeah. They'll just like.
Without a break?
Yeah. I mean, sometimes they'll put on like a little bit like a stream is starting soon, like they or they direct people to other places, or They play an ad, but then, yeah, usually it's just like they'll just put on this kind of like, wow, this like very nice music in the background, and then it's just like, yeah, you know, let's get some of that purple light in here. Yeah.
Hey, wait, you got those nano pads or something,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, I have the... Oh, where did you go, Alice?
I'm sorry, I'm back. I'm so sorry.
It's okay. Yeah, but...
I did as you instructed. I'm sorry. But,
no, it's all good.
Sorry.
It's all good. All good? You're here? A little wobbly?
Okay, I'm back.
Yeah.
Can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear
you.
Okay, good. Yeah, wow. Yeah, you can do, like... Lighting. We were talking about lighting. What are we even talking about? It's time to finish the stream soon. But before we do that, we've got one more question. What are the things you wish you knew earlier?
You know, the thing is, I'm not a person who likes to look backwards. I'm a forward-looking person, and I think everything that happened in the past had to happen for a reason, even the really uncomfortable and painful situation. So I like life the way it is, and that you don't know what tomorrow brings, and so there are probably, yeah, well, I wish I knew that I had a letter, but it's too late
what?
To buy chocolate. I wish I knew I had no chocolate at home.
Oh, you have no chocolate.
Bought chocolate.
Oh, that is such an easy remedy. We can fix that. You know, it might take a couple of days for it to be sent from here, but you know, we can.
It's okay. I prefer German chocolate, so it's okay, right? Thank you very much.
Well, I was only gonna send you the best. I mean, I was gonna send you Swiss chocolate. You know. It's gonna be like amazing.
Oh,
yeah,
cool.
Exactly.
I do like Belgian chocolate.
Oh, yeah. Belgian chocolate is good. It's good. Okay. Well, you know, guys, I think we have... At least, how are you feeling? How are you feeling? First of all, it's up to you. How are you doing?
Oh, I'm feeling good.
You're feeling good? I mean, I think it's time for bed. I think it's time for bed. So, with that being said, guys, thank you for being here.
Thank you.
And thank you, Alice. Yeah, it was really awesome to have you on the stream.
Thank you, Ray.
Thank you for being
so
generous with your time and all of your musical wisdom. And I'm sorry that we, you know, I know there was people in the chat that wanted more videos reviewed. You know, each time I actually say there's a limit of 3, but somehow we end up with 5. So, you know, we have to set the limit somewhere, because I think it's important also that everyone can learn from Alice, how fabulous guest as well, more than just simply like, okay, having your video reviewed. It's nice to be reviewed, but I think there are a lot of important things that Alice has said today that we can definitely take into account. So with that being said, thank you so much, Alice. Thank you for your time. And
well, thank you all.
Yeah,
thank you so much.
And we'll see you again soon.
Bye-bye.
See you, bye. Boomer moment number 45 today. How'd you guys enjoy that stream? Did you guys like it? Yeah. Wasn't Alice just amazing? Yeah. Really awesome person. And, oh, by the way, Luna's question. That's right. Recommending exercises to go back into the piece. Well, I asked Alice, and she said that she believes more in, let's say, practicing the piece of which you are going to play very slowly and just having that, practicing it slowly. Yeah, I'm a terrible messenger, by the way. Practicing it slowly and just switching the metronome up step by step by step. And so that's what she recommends, because all those churny, the other exercises are you know, they're all right, but nothing beats practicing the piece itself. So anyway, that was the answer to that question. Thank you, Luna, for your donation and your question. And for the rest of you, I will see you on Discord. All right, bye for now. Bye.